I used to be a slave. Kept under the thumb of the master. The bastard that made me hunt down my own kin. How did he do that, you ask? With the living scar you see on my cheek, this horror that takes no more than a song sung by Master Dearis to control my very thoughts. But now the tables have turned. I broke my shackles. And when I finally find him, I will make the master sing a very different kind of song.
What's going on, everybody? Mortem here, this time bringing you a lore video about Sabeel, an origin character from Divinity Original Sin 2, and with the recent release of the Godwoken graphic novel explaining the origin character's origin before they actually showed up to Fort Joy, where the game begins, I felt it was time to start covering the lore of these origin characters as I cover quite a bit of Divinity lore on my channel. Sabeel has an amazing story, just like all of the other origin characters, and we are going to cover what we learned from the Godwoken graphic novel, as well as then what we learned in the game. Now keep in mind, once we get to the game portion, Original Sin 2 is a game of player choice, and it has a ton of choices. So because of that, I'm just trying to present what is the most likely outcome, especially given what we know with the next game in the Divinity series that was at least marketed before being put on hiatus, that is Fallen Heroes. That said, Sabeel's quest is actually one of the quests that has tons of outcomes. So just kind of keep that in mind. The very nature of player choice makes exact things particularly hard to nail down. So I'm just trying to give you the overall narrative of her story, as well as what is more than likely canon. As we've learned from the intro, as well as pretty quickly in the novel, Sabeel is a slave assassin. She is enslaved by a lizard Scarmark. So in the Divinity universe, lizards have slaves, for starters, but moreover, they mark them with magical scars. These scars, weirdly enough, respond to music, specifically songs that relate to the individual scars. So when that song is sung, that person becomes unable to resist the will of the master, so to speak, that is singing the song. And through this, we see that Sabeel is being controlled by one of these scars and being used by some mysterious master to kill elves. She was gifted a special dagger called the Needle, though it is interesting that in the game, whenever the Needle is brought up, it's thought to, or at least mentioned as, specifically being like an actual needle. However, in the Godwoken graphic novel, we can very clearly see that it is actually a dagger. Now, Sabeel here is used to kill several elves, but eventually she tries and fails to assassinate a very particular elf, who manages to catch her before she actually goes to deal the death blow. And being very clearly a wizard, he manages to trap Sabeel in various spells, such as like entangling vines and then a frost spell later. But during this conversation, the elf is very clearly confused because he can tell that Sabeel is not in control of her own actions. And after a little investigation, after stopping her assault, he very quickly realizes that while she's not in control of her actions, she is absolutely brimming with source magic. And while realizing that even being slowed down, she would still very much so kill him because her master is in control of her actions, he tells her that she should focus on trying to break free, because with as much source as she has, she should be able to do it, because source, according to this elf, and especially in this instance, it's exactly what he says, is that source is stronger than anything. Now, it is shortly after this encounter that Sabeel manages to do just that. She discovers that through her grief and misery of being entrapped by this master, that she can use that to channel her source powers, which is exactly what she does to break her chains, which is, as it turns out, Sabeel's unique source power that all of the origin characters have, which is literally called Break the Chains, in which Sabeel can use that source ability to basically remove any movement impairing effect, as well as anything really that causes loss of control of your character. Now, once she manages to do this, the master who has been controlling all of the things behind the scenes is not in the building where she was kept. However, she does slaughter absolutely everyone there on her way out. And then after that, she knows that she needs to go to Fort Joy, because that will be the location of a guy named Stingtail, who is the one who branded her with her slave scar, which is how she winds up in Fort Joy after surrendering herself to the Magisters to get sent there. because the Magisters are, as everyone around knows at the time, rounding up sorcerers and sending them to Fort Joy, which very clearly Sabeel is. So that is specifically what we get from the graphic novel, and now let's talk about what we learn from the actual game. So in Act 1, if we have Sabeel in our party or we are playing as her, we will need to of course start by finding Stingtail. Now if you are not playing as Sabeel, she will kill him outright if she's in your party and you bring her to talk to him. More importantly, the information we get from Stingtail is simply that he can't remove the slave scar for her, which is what she was hoping he could do. Only the master who ordered it put on there can do that. So basically what she learns from Stingtail is that she needs to find the master to get rid of the slave scar. Now, the rest of the information in Act 1, it's actually pretty easy to miss, and honestly, even if you do miss it, it doesn't really matter much. But just to explain it, if you go talk to a guy named Griff in the Fort Joy prison, Griff will tell you that you're more than likely looking for a lone wolf, and he'll point you to Zaliskar, which happens to be a lone wolf. Zaliskar is an undead merchant just outside of Fort Joy that you can find. Zaliskar is a lone wolf, and from Zaliskar we can learn that Sabeel was of course abducted by these lone wolves, and that more importantly the exact guy responsible for it is a guy named Roost, which happens to be the leader of the lone wolves, who ordered her capture. Now, that is pretty much all we can learn for Act 1 as far as her specific quest goes, and then from there, all of our origin characters, or any character we're playing for that matter, has to escape the actual island of Fort Joy, which you do as part of the main story. And during the main story, all of the origin characters meet their associated god. In the case of Sabeel, she meets Tyr Syndilius. Unlike most of the other characters, she does not enjoy the prospect of divinity in pretty much any way, shape, or form, because when she speaks to Tyr Syndilius, he speaks to her like she's a slave, just like, you know, pretty much everybody else in her life up to this point. So in that way, Sabeel is kind of the most disassociated from the main quest as far as these origin characters go, but nonetheless, that is who you speak to. And then when we escape Fort Joy, we wind up on Reaper's Coast, specifically in the area of Driftwood. Through a variety of sources, or just stumbling upon it, we will eventually learn the location of Roost on Reaper's Coast. He is at the Culwoods Mill. Now, when we reach Roost, ideally, and again, this can go a lot of different ways, so it might not necessarily be what happens for you, but ideally, a woman named Sahela from Act 1 will have survived, which she should, unless you specifically killed her. But if Sahela survived Act 1, then she will be in Roost's custody in the Culwoods Mill. Now, there's a good chance Roost will just be hostile outright, but no matter what, talking to Roost ends in a fight. So once you fight and defeat him, you can then, of course, free Sahela, along with just, you know, Sabeel being generally happy that the person who actually abducted her and gave her to the master is dead. But at this point, we need to get Sahela out of the mill. Now, it's possible that if you were on your way to the mill, you would have ran into a group of elves, one of which is actually Sahela's mother, who is looking to get her freed. However, it's also possible to find Sahela and then go find the elves as well, but either way, Sahela needs to make it back to these elves. And upon doing so, Sahela will have an incredibly important conversation with Sabeel, where we will learn a ton of information about who Sabeel actually is. Because Sabeel isn't just any old elf. She is what they call the Prime Scion. So scions in elven culture are simply like keepers of memories. They're like elven seers. They have the potential to become ancestor trees. They talk to the mother tree. It's almost like a priest of the elven society. Sabeel is the prime scion, which means she's like their head person. But for whatever reason, Sabeel seems to have either forgotten this or blocked it out one. And we learn from this conversation that Sabeel didn't want to be the prime scion, because what the prime scion's actual role is to potentially become the next mother tree. The mother tree is like the head ancestor tree for elves that essentially rules the elven kind. Sabeel was very scared of becoming the mother tree because the current mother tree spoke of nothing but death and domination. So Sabeel ran, and then she was captured and abducted by Roost, who then gave her to the master, whose identity we do not know yet, and thus is how she became a slave. So, what Sahela will also tell us is that the current mother tree resides on the Nameless Isle, which, for plot reasons, is where we're going next anyway. Because for the main story, our purpose of being in Driftwood is learning to expand our source powers, before trying to claim divinity on the Nameless Isle. So once we advance the main plot, we will eventually find ourselves on the Nameless Isle, and this is actually where Sabile's story comes to an end, unlike most of the other origin characters. Or at least her personal quest wraps up, I should say. There is a lot going on the Nameless Isle for Sabile. There is so much stuff. Most importantly, it is where we can find her master. However, before we actually get going, if Sabile trusts your main character, if you are not playing as her, she will give you the song that controls her slave scar, because she needs you to sing it when she confronts the master so that he can't take control of her, because you'll be able to cancel it out by singing the song yourself. However, if you are playing as Sabile, no matter what, you will break free of the spell of control all by yourself. But eventually, you're going to find yourself in front of either the Mother Tree or the Master, who turns out to be the Shadow Prince. So, just tackling these individually, let's start with the Master. The Master will explain, if you go talk to him, that the reason he had Sabile doing all this is because that the Mother Tree's plan is to grow all these ancestor trees, which will eventually turn into a dryad army with which they plan to take over the world. That is why the Shadow Prince of the Lizard People went through all these lengths to do all this crazy stuff with Sabile, as far as the slave scar and everything goes. He was using her to prevent the Mother Tree from doing its thing, and more importantly, Sabile from becoming the next one. Now, Sabile wants this guy dead, no ifs, ands, or buts. However, it is also possible to do a quest for the Shadow Prince to actually go kill the current Mother Tree for him with a bomb. But obviously, Sabile just wants to kill this guy, which I think is probably the right move, but just keep that in mind. Moreover, if your player character is the Red Prince, you can do a particularly evil thing, which is to actually sell Sabile, if she's in your party and you're playing as the Red Prince, to the Shadow Prince, which is beyond words awful, but there you go, there's that. Now, the other side of this, the Mother Tree. If we bring Sabile to the Mother Tree, obviously it will want Sabile, of course, to become the next Mother Tree like she's supposed to, supposedly. Now, more importantly, the Mother Tree also wants the Shadow Prince dead, so that actually works out. Now, after you leave the initial conversation with the Mother Tree, if Sahela is still alive, she'll come find you and basically say that, you know, you should probably just kill the Mother Tree, because what the Mother Tree actually is a controlling tyrant. And really, is just another slave master, just under a different name. Now, once you've dealt with the Shadow Prince, you can come back to the Mother Tree, at which point it will basically force Sabile into a choice, which is become the Mother Tree or don't. You can agree to this. You can let Sabile agree to it, in which case she will eventually become the next Mother Tree. Or you can refuse, because again, understanding that this is just a different form of slavery, really. Now, the key thing to remember here, though, is that the Mother Tree is dying regardless. Because of all the death fog in Lucian's War Against the Black Ring, which led to this game, the Mother Tree was severely wounded by this and is dying. It's just a matter of time until the current Mother Tree is dead, which is why they are putting all this emphasis on making Sabile the next one. If Sabile refuses this, she's effectively ending the Mother Tree's reign over elves. And more importantly, she's truly freeing herself. So that is the end of the personal quest for Sabile, is all of those decisions. You kind of, you know, pick an outcome and that's where it ends. Obviously, the actual game continues on to Act 4, where the main story wraps up. Where, of course, you know, you can choose all the other endings if you're playing as Sabile or she's in your party. Due to the marketing that was given for Fallen Heroes before it was put on hiatus, we can make quite a few educated guesses as to what Sabile goes on to do after this. So Fallen Heroes is planned to take place 2 years after Divinity Original Sin 2, in which all of the Godwoken are seen alive and well, which would leave us to believe that Sabile has most likely rejected all of the offers of the Mother Tree. However, even if you accept, Sabile doesn't like immediately turn into the Mother Tree and leave your party. So in theory, it's possible for her to have accepted that fate and then Fallen Heroes to have, you know, like still taken place, I guess is my point. So while I think it's safe to assume that the safe bet is probably the happy ending where Sabile is free of all her captors, safe to say that they could potentially still write in that no, she actually chose to become the next Mother Tree. That could be a thing that happens. But we do know that she is alive. And moreover, that the canonical ending to Original Sin 2 is more than likely the source is purged from the world, as per Lucian's plan. Which is why we see Sabile not purged of source, or anything like that. And there you go, guys. That is Sabile's personal story. Personally, I think the right thing to do, if you hadn't gathered, is to free her from all of her captors, because she has led a terrible life, and has a very emotionally moving story for me personally, which is why she's one of my favorite origin characters. So I certainly hope you guys enjoyed the video. I hope you guys stick around and subscribe. And if you would give the video a like, comment, and subscribe to help me out, that would be awesome as well. But either way, thank you so much for watching. May you wander in wisdom and have an amazing day.